In the last 20 years, the business of journalism has changed out of all recognition. Traditional newspapers are finding it harder and harder to keep going. And new forms of activity, which call themselves journalism, have started up in the digital world. A new book, Out of Print, looks at where journalism has been and where it may be going. The author is George Brock, once a senior editor at The Times, now Professor of Journalism at City University in London. George Brock, you say in this book somewhere that journalism today is a living experiment, but it is not in ruinous decline. Now, if I were working for an old-fashioned newspaper, I might quarrel with that because it looks pretty ruinous to me if I work for a newspaper.
If you do work for a newspaper, of course things don't look that good, and there's nothing wrong with that point of view. But journalism is more than newspapers, and it's more than the newspapers that are threatened. What's happened in the disruption that's occurred is that the business model of big, daily, general interest newspapers is very threatened. But there's a lot of other journalism going on. It's going on in magazines, it's going on in other kinds of newspapers, it's going on in television, it's going on online. So one wants to be careful that you don't see the whole scene just as pictured by a small, threatened subspecies, which are the very big editorial stars of the big newspapers. They are going to have a tough time.
Yeah, small proportionately to the overall journalism world, but high profile and significant. What is it that has put them in such peril? Their business model, which depended on advertising, is broken. Is that it?
It really is, if you want to express it in a single sentence, it's the decline of advertising. People don't any longer, in lucrative volume, want to buy ads in newspapers on the same scale that they used to do. The first dependent on small ads, classified ads, jobs, houses, cars. That kind of snippety information, if you like. Classified advertising. That's one of the reasons why American newspapers declined so fast. They were heavily dependent on local classified advertising of that kind, and that's why they slumped early on.
Now, one of the things that seems to be happening as a result of this is more and more journalism goes online as journalists and news organizations look for new ways to survive and to make money, is that we're going back to a rather scrappy model of journalism, which actually was how journalism started in the 18th, 19th centuries. All sorts of people paying for it, all sorts of vested interest. It's not, is it, the kind of authoritative, trustworthy journalism that has always been presented in the 20th century as the ideal?
For a very long time, journalism was messy, opinionated, chaotic, and a lot of it very unsavory. What you might call the high modern period of big daily papers really didn't last for very long. It's roughly speaking the second half of the 20th century. Big daily papers as we know them in America and Europe came to their real power and influence in the 1920s and 30s. And actually, if you look at the numbers, they began to go into decline in the 1950s. British newspapers, national newspapers, began to slide downwards in the 1950s. The peak year for the circulation of the Daily Mirror, 1966.
So the internet's not solely responsible for the demise?
It's certainly not solely responsible for the demise. It's made things a lot tougher and a lot harder. But everything contributed. The growth of television, the growth of radio, satellite and cable, all of those things were kind of hammer blows driving down the relative importance of print.
Now, a lot of journalism these days is digital. It's websites launched by organizations like the BBC, by newspapers and so on. It's also startup websites, things which didn't exist in the past. If you wanted to characterize modern digital journalism, how would you do it? What makes it different from the old-fashioned, traditional journalistic approach?
What it allows, in a simple sentence, is greater choice. In other words, if you don't have a choice in the pre-existing, in the pre-digital age, it's likely that digital is going to supply it. Let's take the example of America. American journalism, on the whole, very serious, very sober, very respectable at the daily paper level. Not many papers that we would call tabloid or popular papers in America were surviving. A few, but not many. What digital has done is to give back to American journalism that rather raunchy, anarchic, sometimes fairly tasteless aspect of journalism that exists in most free societies. It's what offended journalists would call down-market journalism. But some of it is very bouncy, very clever, very quick, very funny. That's what people like. Or it's one of the things people like.
There is, though, an issue, isn't there? What worries so many people, so many observers, inside and outside journalism, is that it has become more and more difficult to sustain journalistic enterprises which have the resources, which have the expertise to do trustworthy journalism properly. And surely that is the big threat posed by digital media.
It is a big threat that is posed, but one of the reasons that I wrote this book was to convince people of my own, was to try and convince people of my own view, which is that I think the corner has been turned. The tilting point we've reached. You can look at some of these online news businesses and you can see the big possible journalism institutions of the future. These are not, they're not all tiny startups anymore. And some of these people are beginning to challenge the existing existing journalistic powers as disruptors, if you like. I visited one called Gothamist.com, which reports New York, and their target is the metro, that's to say the local city section of the New York Times. They've got only about 10 people so far, but if they get to 20 people, they say, well, we can take on the metro section of the New York Times, which employs 60 journalists, so we're three times better than they are. Now, that's a hubristic claim, but it may turn out to be true.
Newspapers, come back to newspapers. There is a lot of speculation that before long, some big titles here in the UK will opt for online digital publication only, that they'll get rid of all that expensive business of dead trees and printing and distribution. Do you think that will happen, and which ones will go first?
Well, there's a dinner party game you can play betting which newspaper will switch off its printed version first. A lot of people, when they're looking at British papers, choose The Guardian because it's been very advanced and very innovative in its online. My personal bet is that if I was looking across British newspapers, I'd pick the Financial Times to wind down its print version first. I don't think it'll happen quite that radically as you imply. I think people will go down to once a week or twice a week, and they will see how that works and whether they can keep the people who mind about the printed version not being there, and there'll be experiments and so on. But most big newspapers don't believe they will be buying new printing presses, so at a kind of 20-year scale on the outside, they won't be there, and some of them think it will be between 5 and 10 years. Two big things are going to happen in the next few years. People are going to start switching off print or not doing print every day in very big journalism institutions that we know, and the other thing is that high-tech companies are going to start buying newspapers. You saw it the other day with Jeff Bezos buying the Washington Post.
George Brock, thank you very much indeed.
My pleasure.